especially some of these questions about sustainability, because it is truly a growing aspect of engineering. And the question was posed was, how quickly is this happening? And I think, and this is just my own opinion, I think the way it works is, as the old duckers leave positions of authority, such as those controlling professional licensure and so forth, making room for the newer old duffers like Chris and me, that's how the transition is going to happen. So we're slowly shifting the curriculum at UMass Dartmouth from strictly hard engineering courses with a smattering of humanities, because as you know, we all had pocket protectors back in the day, pointy heads and so forth, which people use words like rounding them off. Well, that's what they're talking about, is rounding them off and getting rid of the pointy head. So we are making some progress there. The project that I'm going to talk about today was a research project some years back that helped change my thinking. We talked about siloing, I guess, and the question is, why do I have to take these liberal arts courses? Are they going to make me a better engineer or not? And your typical freshman, sophomore, and junior engineer will say, absolutely not, it's a waste of my time. How is this going to help me get a professional registration? Well, it was through this particular project that, honestly, history came home really hard to me in such a fun way. And the consequence of that was, I put together a talk for the Quinebaug River Watershed Association, knowing full well that these aren't technical people, but they have a passion for their river, and for many reasons. So we talk about stakeholders in the process. Well, when you come to issues like this, they are highly politicized. Which I learned working for the government of Saudi Arabia, which I learned working for MassDEP. There's absolutely no way you can get away from it, versus the classic engineer, you stick him in the cubicle and he sits there and grinds numbers. Well, fortunately, in civil and environmental engineer, remember, civil engineers, civic works, a lot of what we do is for government. And the consequence is, since it's for government, it's paid by government, and therefore the engineers have to be accountable for it, especially when it comes to cost, because it's your tax dollars at work. Okay, so we're going to talk about history helping science and this particular river. First, I thought I'd talk about the birth of environmental engineering. I was told that was kind of the focus of this session. In my opinion, it sort of began with the Federal Water Pollution Control Act of 1948, and it was the first major U.S. legislation to address water pollution. Growing public awareness and concern about water pollution, following Earth Day, and particularly back in 1970, led to sweeping amendments of the Water Pollution Control Act of 1972, and these new revisions collectively became known as the Clean Water Act, and that has since been revised a handful of times. So environmental engineering as a profession evolved from sanitary engineering. So at MIT, for example, the old course 26 was sanitary engineering. That program disappeared in 1962. But the Department of Civil Engineering didn't become the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering until about 1992. But what happened here is, because of the Clean Water Act, this profession picked up steam as technical specialists were needed to design and build the advanced wastewater treatment plants that were needed to mitigate the pollution of our rivers and lakes from municipal and industrial discharge. So back in the day, and there are a few of you here old enough to remember this, there were rivers in Massachusetts that changed color every week. Why would that be? Anybody have a guess?
Say it was being.
Who here? Yes.
The dyes that were expelled from some of the manufacturing firms would get expelled into the river and change the color of the thing, we'll call it their dyeing, whatever material it's made from, paper.
Who played with construction paper when you were a kid? So after they were done dyeing the paper, the stuff was simply dumped into the river. Simply dumped into the river. Isn't that astonishing now? Well, that was normal back then. And the hippies rose up and said, we ain't going to take it anymore. And they moved the place. So the major emphasis of the Clean Water Act was on water quality and pollution control. But a little known facet of it is that the Clean Water Act also focuses on water quantity. So we were basically charged up to deal with pollution control issues back then. But water quantity wasn't such an important aspect, or it didn't get the consideration. So following the Arab oil embargo of 1973 and 1979, rising fuel costs have water resource engineers take a look at small-scale hydropower. So, gee, it's costing a lot of money here to generate electricity because it's using fuel oil and so forth. How about renewable energy? Who thinks that's a great idea? I think we all do. Unfortunately, when it comes to small-scale hydropower, there's pushback, and we'll talk about that. Here in the Northeast U.S., believe it or not, accounting by the United States Army Corps of Engineers back in the late 70s, tabulated 10,000 small dams here in New England. And it's these small dams that powered the Industrial Revolution here in the U.S. So in fact, it was thanks to this hydropower that we have here, flowing rivers thanks to plentiful rain, that New England was the leading economy of the world in the 1840s. So some of these old systems were rehabilitated and some new systems were designed and constructed. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service developed what are so-called minimum stream flow guidelines back in the late 70s to assure that downstream ecosystems aren't going to be damaged by these hydropower operations. Chris mentioned one aspect about a dam is you can hold all the water back, but the price of that is the flow in the river is going to be altered and in some ways damaged. Well, water allocation in the western U.S. has been a contentious issue for over a century, and Chris alluded to this. In the Northeast U.S., the issue is still new. Remember the movie Chinatown? It was all about water allocation. The Colorado River was split up through the Colorado River Compact in 1921. The compact basically decided among the seven western states as to who gets how much water and when. Well, the interesting idea about the Colorado River Water Compact is the amount of water that was allocated was based on flow observation made in the late 1800s, and the average flows during that period were higher than the long-term average. So already we've over-allocated the river. Here, in 1979 and 1980, we had a short but severe drought during which the Ipswich River dried up. The Ipswich River is north of Boston. It's a fairly flat river. And as a consequence, and for those of you at UMass Amherst, believe it or not, the campus closed for a week in the fall of 1980 because the Amherst water supply was too low to help sustain the 25,000 plus students at UMass Amherst. So as a consequence, after several efforts and attempts, the Massachusetts State Legislature enacted the Massachusetts Water Management Act in 1985. So existing users of more than 100,000 gallons a day had to register their water withdrawals. So this would be industrial users, municipal water suppliers, and so forth. Even cranberry operations, because they use a tremendous amount of water to raise cranberries. And then new withdrawals would require a permit from the Mass DEP Water Management Program. Given growing support for the idea of Well, we need to sustain minimum stream flows. The environmental activists took up the cause. Well, I basically spent many years trying to convince them that this was physically impossible, so this was my local political engagement, and it's one of the reasons I wound up here. So, the Quinebaug River, now I've kind of followed up to, or led up to this point here. So we have a natural gas-fired power plant that's under construction in Charlton, Mass. We happen to have natural gas lines that happen to cross the site. And they applied for a permit under the water management program to withdraw cooling water for their power plant. So a gas-fired combined cycle plant is basically a jet engine, almost literally a jet engine that's put on a frame, and then we get all those hot exhaust gases from the jet engine and use that to heat water to steam. So we're doing energy recovery. So now that steam is run through a steam turbine, so now we have a more efficient generating system. And here's the weird part, and this is something that took me a while to understand, and this is a great opportunity to explain it to you. So we've gone through all this effort to boil this water into steam, we run it through turbine, and then we cool all that water off only to boil it again. Does this sound like kind of a stupid idea? Why don't we just keep it as steam, right? Well, that's kind of the wonder of thermodynamics, which most mechanical engineering students fear, but eventually survive. So there are physical laws that basically say, well, gee, when we cool that steam to water, we create a vacuum that actually sucks the steam through the turbine, and we generate yet more water, more power still. So the consequence of this is, now we have hot water, which we need to cool down to create that better vacuum. So in this particular power plant, the approach was, well, we're going to withdraw about 2 million gallons of water a day from this tributary of the Quinebaug and evaporate it, and that's going to do the job. Well, the wonderful thing about the hydrologic cycle that Chris also alluded to is that during the summer, the rivers and streams run much more slowly than they do in the spring. So, in engineering, we have special technical language to describe an occurrence like this. When the river runs dry, as far as the fishery is concerned, technically speaking, this is considered bad. Well, I happen to have a degree in zoology, so I have an appreciation for what dead fish means. And so I also agreed this was a bad idea. And so did EPA, Connecticut Fish and Game, Connecticut DEP, Mass Fish and Wildlife, a whole host of players. So Mass DEP and the US EPA split stream gauge data into pre-1962 and post-1962 data sets to examine low flow statistic that was being banded about as this is the minimum stream flow rate we have to maintain. And this is called the August Daily Q50. So some of you no doubt have some exposure to statistics. So the 50 stands for the median value. And it's a simple statistic. I know we all know how to calculate an average. The median is almost as easy. You take all your data, sort it from large to small, and half of the data lies on one side of the median, and the other half of the data lies on the other side. So as the Three Stooges said, hi, deedle, deedle, right down the needle, that's the median. Okay, everybody got that idea? Well, here's a really important concept. I said, well, the environmental activists said we have to sustain this, but here's the rub. By definition, 50% of the time, flows are this is why you're science librarian. Thank you. You have no idea how many years I've spent trying to explain this to people who just didn't want to hear it. They're out there still. So, we do analysis of this sort of stuff. This is what I like to do when I get up. So before 1962, the August median was 0.51 cubic feet per second per square mile of watershed. So watershed is basically a topographic bathtub. What happens when your kids leave the shower curtain open and turn on the shower? Get water on the floor, right? Well, the stuff that winds up in the bathtub, the ring of the bathtub is your watershed. So there's a potential for any precipitation that falls inside the rim of the bathtub, making it out to the drain. It won't necessarily do so, but it might, okay? So we talk about watershed areas in terms of square miles. And cubic feet per second, well, we can convert that to gallons and so forth too, and we'll see how that's done. So before 1962, we were at 0.51. I know it's a meaningless number, and that's okay. But after 1962, it dropped like a rock.
Wow.
So 40% fall in the August stream flow, and everyone said, holy cow, look at this. Technically speaking, this is probably
bad.
Right? So that difference is 0.19 CFS per square mile, literally 40%. 1962 marks the completion of three U.S. Army Corps of Engineer flood control dams. One at East Brimfield, one at Westville, both in Massachusetts, and the third in West Thompson, Connecticut. So I heard somebody say, oh, so who was that? What are you thinking?
That's your
what
source.
What might have happened with the construction of the dams?
That's the source of the difference.
That could be. So you've just made a hypothesis. That could be the source of the difference. So as a good scientist, you're going to say, let's explore it. I actually wasn't being paid to do this, but I asked the same question and said, how is this possible? And, you know, I think about stream flow and stuff. That's what I do when I get up in the morning. I said, how is this possible? Now, the US EPA concluded that pre-1962 flows were more natural, and that post-1962 flows are impaired. Maybe for the reasons you just suggested. It might be the flood control reservoirs. It might be, but we need to take a look at this idea. So a concern that the cooling water withdrawal might adversely impact the river, which is code word for dry the darn thing up. US EPA asked Millennium Power Plant to fund a study to investigate the feasibility of restoring and enhancing the Quinebaug River's native fishery and recreational opportunities. Remember, they've decided that it's damaged, so the study is going to go about restoring. Great. Well, this is a power plant. The owners also own the Breakpoint coal-fired power plant. They were a subsidiary of Pacific Gas and Electric. Nobody felt really bad about hitting them up for a bundle of money to do this study. So Cornell was responsible for the fishery biology study. And my group here at UMass was responsible for the watershed hydrology, the river flow, and the reservoir operations analysis study. So here's a site. One of your colleagues here is from the Coast Guard Academy, which is down here at the bottom of the Thames River. And somewhere I happen to have a pointer here. So here's where the academy is. The study area is here, north of West Thompson, up to the west on the Quinebaug, where this is the French River here. Big body of water on the French River. That's a pretty cool Native American name. Anybody have any idea what it might be?
Lake Webster.
And that is English translation for Lake
Charterbog.
Did everyone hear that? Now we're also going to ask her to spell.
I could write it, but
I couldn't do either. So the Quinebaug is about 180 square miles, and it's a sub-watershed of the Thames. And the fishery focus area here is literally just a few hundred yards upstream of the Quinebaug confluence with the Fren, where the Thames begins. So the first hypothesis, hey, the Army Corps Reservoir recreation lakes are responsible for reducing summertime flow. Typically, the Army Corps flood control reservoirs have a recreation lake so that people can boat on them and fish on them and so forth and enjoy them, because you basically had to move people out of the land that the lake would fill, so you got to get them out there anywhere, so give them a break and let them go in there and fish and so forth. So these are called recreation pools. And then when the National Weather Service, which here in the Northeast is actually located in Taunton, issues a flood forecast, then the gates of the flood control project reservoir shut, and they start accumulating water which would otherwise go hammering down the river and wreck stuff. Well, technically speaking, also considered. So let's look at some of the hydrology here. The August average monthly precipitation is just under 4 inches. We're blessed here in the Northeast. It's pretty much 4 inches all year round. But we have higher evaporation rates in August. They're up around 6 inches. Believe it or not, there is evaporation in January. Who else is a cheapskate and hangs their wash outside? Does it dry in the winter?
Like 30 minutes.
Why?
Because the air is so dry.
The air is so dry. And it's a process called sublimation, where water can actually evaporate from ice to the gas phase without having to be liquid. So when I was whipped into dragging in the laundry at age 7, I learned very early on about this stuff. So it's not zero. So the difference is really 2.5 inches. Well, okay. Well, maybe that might explain it. So now we have evaporation instead of rainfall. Now, lake evaporation rates actually are greater than evapotranspiration from the land surface. So if basically we flooded some of the land, then we've got greater evaporation rates, and so consequently the river flows ought to fall. Does that seem like a reasonable idea? That's what I thought too. And I'm really smart, so so by increasing that lake area, the flows in the river are diminished, especially during the summer when evaporation rates are high. So it seemed like a reasonable idea. So let's test it. And you're probably thinking, oh my God, it's going to kill me with calculus and all this stuff, and I'll slash my wrists, and you know, I won't have a good dinner tonight, and I'm dead. Well, lucky for us, we've got some fabulous resources to use. The University of New Hampshire, and who's a rep from here?
Woo!
Great. You guys have parked on your website scanned U.S. topographic maps from the late 1800s. It's free. They're easy to download. So if you wonder what your community, what your neighborhood looked like in 1880, go to UNH. A total treat. Now, before East Brimfield was constructed, it was called Long Pond, so we can see that on this side. And we have to use the pointer here. So when the reservoir was constructed, all this area now is flooded, or it wasn't before. You can also see how the roads have, in some ways, stayed the same. So here's what Long Pond looked like in 1900. You can actually see this from the Mass Pike as you're climbing the hill, heading eastbound towards Sturbridge, so it's going to be on the south side of the pike. Here's a picture of Long Pond after the dam was breached by what we used to call freshets back then, basically a flood. Farmers were basically used to their hand-laid stone dams blowing out in the spring. So part of the deal was get back in the water, stack the rocks back up, and go back to doing what you're doing. Just part of life here in New England. So here's what remains of the old control gates here at Long Pond. And the bottom picture here on the left, or I'm sorry, on the right, is East Springfield Lake today. This large structure here is where the flood control gates are. So they're actually lifted up into this shaft here. This thing here is called a weir box. It's basically a box with a couple of 2x2 foot gates in it that are actually used to maintain flows in the river, because there's a contract between the people who used to run this and the federal government. So we'll talk about that a little bit more in a while. So after 1962, the lake surface was 360 acres. Long Pond was 200 acres. So we've got 160 acres. We aren't seeing any calculus, so far so good, right? So from 160 acres of lake surface during August, there's a net difference. We call the word flux, just because if it sounds hard, they'll pay us more. 2.4 inches per month, which we do a little bit of algebra, but we can actually convert this to cubic feet per second per square mile. Just a little bit of multiplication and division, and we'll get there. So we'll compare that with the pre-62 and post-62 Q50s. So 0.01 CFS per square mile is a heck of a lot less than 0.19 CFS per square mile. So what do you think of this hypothesis?
Doesn't work.
Good one? Not so good.
Doesn't work.
This is why you're science librarian. Yep. So 1 CFS per square mile is 1 cubic foot per second per square mile of contributing watershed. And 1 CFS is 7.5 gallons. So everyone puts milk in the fridge, so now you got an idea as to how much a cubic foot would take up. This is also equal to almost 2/3 of 1 million gallons of water per day. So these are actually pretty big numbers. So the fact is, if East Springfield Recreation Lake evaporates more water than Long Pond did all year round, not just during August, then the annual average daily stream flow is going to be reduced as well. So let's compare those two statistics. 1.75 CFS per square mile. So what do you think happened to the pre? More or less? By a lot? By a little? Anybody willing to put up any money? This is why you're a science librarian. Incidentally, you know, in my introduction, I was mentioned that I had originally aspired to be a Formula One mechanic. Well, just in case you were unaware of, Liz Winiars knows how to strip a Hewlin Mark 9 gearbox as fast as anyone. I know. Let's hear it for Liz. So, pre-1962, holy cow, it's a little bit more. So, something is really weird here. Conclusion, we're going to toss this one out. What do you think?
Yeah,
that's what I thought too. All right. So, Okay, second hypothesis. Well, in 1962, the climate was a little bit wetter, as 1962 marked the start of the 60s drought of record. Starting in 1962 and going up to about 1968, we had deficit rainfall for nearly 4 years. My family lived in the hills outside of Amherst in the town of Pelham, and our well dried out. So for a couple of years, we were hauling water out of a spring using 35-gallon milk cans. And I'll tell you what, that helped keep my mom in shape, that's for sure. But the consequence of that is, you know, we dug a deeper well and made it through. So if the summertime climate was wetter before 1962, then the summertime flows in the Quinebaug might be higher. So this sounds like a reasonable idea. And if the summertime climate isn't different, there shouldn't be any significant statistical difference between the pre and post 62 summertime stream flow. So I'm already starting to sneak in words used by statisticians, but again, no calculus involved here, no innocent animal sacrifice. So what we're going to do is use what's called the trend test. Everyone's heard about trend tests before, especially when you're considering what's the state of my 401k. Kind of ugly, huh? So we're going to use that to see if there's a difference between pre and post 62 climate and pre and post 62 stream flows. So if their trends seem to be similar, then maybe we're on to something. So we're going to split daily precipitation into pre 62 and post 62 data sets, just like EPA and MassDEP did. We're going to estimate daily evaporation, daily precipitation, an average daily stream flow month by month. So the way this is done, if I have 30 years worth of daily data, then I'm going to generate 30 values of August averages. So each calendar year, I estimate an average for the flows during August. So everybody get that idea? I'm also going to do the same thing for every August in this 30-year record. I'm going to estimate the median daily flow for each month by month by month. So I'm going to have 30 numbers. So everybody on board. This is great. And then what I'm going to do month by month is successfully add a month's average to the preceding sum of all the other months. Okay? So first month I have the month average. The second value is this month plus last month. The next month I have this month plus the preceding two. Calculus warning. This process is called integration. Okay? Everybody gets it. It's nothing fancier than that. It just uses words, you know, smoke and mirrors so that they can get more money. Really, I know about this stuff. So what we're simply going to do is add all these successively up together. And are the slopes of these things going to be the same or different? So we did that using Worcester Airport data. Since it's an airport, we actually have trained weather observers here, which is why this is really high quality stuff. And so we have pre-1962 are the open circles, and post-1962 are the black circles. And although there's a bit of a shift, the slopes are virtually identical. Everybody? So because they're identical, there's really no difference. So in the trend analysis, we say, is there a statistically significant difference between the slopes? No way, Jose. So much for the climate. Well, how about the stream flow? Whoa. Now there's something really awesome happening here. So before 1962, we've got the values climbing up, and then there's an enormous jump. This was just totally amazing to see. So no, I hadn't read about this in a journal article. This is what I get up in the morning and do and stuff, and it just, wow, this is really cool. So something really significant happened just a few years before 1962 to cause this jump. So these are the sums of these monthly average daily values. Obviously, there's a significant difference. We can use this as an eyeball trend test. Your eyeball says, yep, they're different. So we can use statistics and confidence intervals and fancy stuff like that, or we can rely on our eyeball. So what do you think? Not bad, huh? This is why you're science librarian. So the huge jump occurs indicates that there was an enormous amount of water in the Quinebaug during August 1955. Shakespeare said portents of things to come. Well, during August 11th through 14th, Hurricane Connie dropped 5 inches of rain. On the 17th to the 20th, Hurricane Diane dropped 13 inches of rain. Literally, just a handful of days later. Because the soil was already saturated from Hurricane Connie, the rainfall from Diane didn't soak into the ground because the ground was already full and it just raged into the river, flooding the Quinebaug and all its tributaries. Now, interestingly enough, I actually remember these. I was 3 years old, I guess, at the time, and I remember water coming in the windows from the east of our house up on top of Helen Hill. And my parents totally freaking out with towels trying to keep the water out. And I'm remembering this at age 3, which is pretty, pretty amazing. Like falling dominoes, the flood wave from one breach dam raced downriver to breach the next. Wipe them all out in one day. Virtually every dam in the watershed was breached. I switched over to the monthly media now, and I basically split it to pre and post Hurricane Diane, and we can see there is a remarkably consistent slope in the pre-62, actually the pre-55, and the post-55. So there's lots of water in the river, actually, not just pre-62, but pre-55, and lots less water because the slope is fatter. Again, this is a calculus field, which is a fancy word for saying add all that stuff up. Things are changing at a slower rate. So here's Big Pond Dam. This is in Southbridge, Mass. The river's going over the banks. This is just before the breach. This is the breach, picture in Worcester Telegram. This happens to be the highway superintendent pointing towards one of the factory buildings here. Yep. I think that's the problem. So here we are, the big dam is breached. This is the Worcester Telegram, which unfortunately I think is no longer. It's a great newspaper.
Does
everyone know how to pronounce Worcester properly?
Worcester. Yeah. See, I was born in the weird one in Ohio that is not said right or spelled right. Worcester.
So does everyone, now that you're here, does everyone know how to properly know how to pronounce New Bedford? New Bedford. So if you go to a restaurant here off campus and stuff, people won't mistake you for somebody, you know, in another part of the country. Not looking real good. Charlie's used car lot a few months later. Nice clean Hudson Hornet. This is Glen Echo Lake. This is on one of the tributaries to the Quinebaug. This is up in Charlton, which is where the rest stop is on the Mass Pike. This is just a bit south of the rest stop. Yes, it is barely south of the rest stop. On the right-hand side is Route 20, where Charlton Brook crosses under Route 20. So this is just a bit east of Sturbridge. And yes, these rocks should not be in the middle of the road.
I think I totally know where that hill is.
I'm sure you do. Yeah. So in fact, there's a new service station just off here to the right. That's it. Here we are in Putnam, Connecticut. So we actually see the flood wave crashing over the highway. It's totally amazing. So
In August. But it's not March.
Not March. Although you raised some good points. Just FYI, the flooding in Texas has been storms on the order of 16 inches. But it's also really flat down there, which is why they're getting hammered, so it's a very slow flood. But here, we've got lots of elevation change, so the water is going really fast, and it has, just like when you run down the hallway and ram into the door, F equals MA, right? Lots of energy. Big deal. That's why all the dams blew out. Well, here we are a year later, a new bridge has been put in. So, conclusion, reject hypothesis two. There's no significant difference between pre-62 and post-62 precipitation, and in fact, pre-1962 was actually a little bit drier, not wetter. But there's a significant difference between pre-62 and post-62. The pre-62 was significantly greater than the post-62 stream flow for sure. And a visual trend test suggests that there was a major change in the river in August 1955. You know, all the dams blew out, right? That's a big change. Third hypothesis. It's 1955. Who buys this one? Not a chance. Klingon bastards. In fact, I was just reading in, I think Business Week, I guess it was, that somebody has produced a new Star Trek, or producing a new Star Trek movie that's catching hold on YouTube and so forth, and CBS and the original guys are going after him with the lawyers, which is Cincinnati. So, hypothesis four. The difference between pre-55 and post-55 is due to the lake and reservoir management by the textile industry. This is where the history starts. And this is what really made this study fun for me. And I know there's a handful of historians here in the room, and I hope you'll enjoy it too. In 1835, the Quinebaug Reservoir Company was incorporated by the Massachusetts General Corps. So back in the old days, when you wanted to incorporate, you had to go before the Massachusetts General Court versus hire your lawyer or go online and mail in $50 and you're suddenly incorporated. And it was incorporated for the purpose of constructing reservoirs at the sources and up the several tributary streams of the Quinebaug for the increase of water power of said river and for the mutual benefit of the mills and manufacturing establishments on said river and its tributaries. Well, remember that Slater has only recently smuggled plans for textile technology and established the textile industry in U.S. in defiance of English law. And so because of the water power, the textile industry is really picking up steam. By 1865, only 30 years later, the Quinebaug Reservoir Company owned or controlled virtually all of the water rights above and including Southbridge, Massachusetts, which basically meant if somebody's got a mill, these guys bought it up and said, okay, if the water spills over the dam, you can use that, otherwise it's ours. And we're going to use it for textiles. By 1925, all these smaller companies consolidated into the Hamilton Woolen Company, and this comprised most of the major textile firms in both Sturbridge and Southbridge. The Hamilton Woolen Company, by now, was virtually the Quinebaug River Reservoir Company, and they retained ironclad control over the waters of the Quinebaug watershed, all with the goal of producing textiles. Now, by the late 19th century, oil and coal-fired steam boilers are producing more power than the mill's hydromechanical turbine system can. So we need water, not just for power, but for other reasons. So we have textile, and we also have an optical industry there. And they still need lots of water for process and manufacturing, in addition to this boiler makeup water, and also for process cooling. Everything changes in 1935. Due to labor issues, Hamilton Woolen Company liquidates rather than concede to union demands. Organizers came up from New York. And in fact, what happened was the president of the Hamilton Woolen Company aspired to a national position in some U.S. woolen organization. He said, I'm going to show that I'm tough. We're basically going to shut the place down rather than let them unionize. So all their assets, including the water rights now, are purchased by J.P. Stevens of New York and the Ames Textile Corporation of Lowell. The area of the Ames Worsted Company begins. So Ames Worsted suffers its share of challenges, both economic and natural. Big Pond Dam was breached intentionally during the flood of March 1936 and the September hurricane of 1938. It was rebuilt both times. According to Mr. Ames Stevens in Hinder and Yon with Spindle and Loom, this is a book that he basically published for his family, and his son kindly gave me a copy. So water in our business never seemed to mix well. Following the 36 Merrimack River flood, which was the March flood of 1936 and affected more than just simply the Merrimack, the 1938 hurricane washed out our Southbridge Dam and bridges and damaged a lot of material. But the 55 hurricane, all rain and no winds, really finished us at Southbridge. All the dams were washed out and the river came roaring through the mill, literally washing cloth down the river, tearing out the boilers, generators, and water wheels. The plant as an operating unit was a total wreck, and no flood insurance could have been bought. So Hurricane Diane and Connie, which people often forget, was the straw that broke the back of the Ames Worsted Company. So the water rights that they owned were sold off along with the other Ames Worsted Company assets. The rights to Long Pond were sold to the American Optical Company, which was a leading world leader in manufacturing glasses. In fact, the river would occasionally run red because of the rouge that they used to polish the glass lenses and then discharge into the river. The other rights were literally given to the surrounding towns. So industrial control over the Quinebaug River comes to an end in 1955. An interesting aspect of the 55 hurricane was, here in the Northeast US, in New England in particular, the states had been arguing over agreement on aspects of what's called the Flood Control Compact. And this argument started happening in 1927, following some major flooding here in the Northeast. It's also coincident with major flooding on the Mississippi River, where several hundred people were killed down in New Orleans. So 30 years of wrangling, we finally start to have agreements, and the Army Corps can start building these flood control projects here. So West Thompson and Westville each maintain a recreation pool, but East Springfield releases water during low stream flow periods in accordance with the agreement between American Optical and the federal government, because American Optical now owns the water rights, or in fact a portion of the water rights in East Springfield Reservoir. So the former Hamilton Woolen Company reservoirs are no longer drowned for industrial needs, such as during dry flow times in the summer, but instead are kept full for recreation. So summer homes and all year round homes have been built up around many of these now, and they are lovely lakes to enjoy in the summer. So the historic evidence suggested to me that today the Quinebaug River is actually flowing in a more natural condition than it did before 1955. Because starting in 1835, they're storing water and releasing it in the summer when they need it, and artificially boosting flows in the river. Well, I do math and that sort of stuff, so I said, okay, I'm going to use the historic records, and I'm going to develop a computer-based math model, which is what I also do when I get up in the morning. So here are the historic facts that allowed me to do this. No records exist as to how Ames Worsted staff operated the industrial lakes and reservoirs. Known operators have long since passed away. This was many years ago, well, 60 years ago. In 1920, though, and thanks to the fine librarians in Southbridge, I was able to get a hold of some copies of company newsletters. And in this particular one, in 1920, the Hamilton Lawn Company used 57 million gallons of water a day. And the complex consisted of three major components, and that water was recycled. So the first is the Big Pond Dam. This had a powerhouse and a canal that fed the brick mill. Big Pond Dam and Hamilton Brick Mill Complex. This is a wonderful illustration from books of county maps that were produced in the late 1800s. Many of you are probably familiar with these. Very large, probably most of yours have been slit up with razors, and maps are now in frame somewhere, but these were wonderful books. And this is the Big Pond Dam, which was the cover sheet for my presentation here. Lovely pastoral area. We see, interesting enough, we see lots of pasture here, but today there are trees. What do you suppose happened? What happened to all the trees back then?
During the farming and settlement of the area.
And for fuel?
For what reason?
Farming and pasture and use wood.
What is it that we do here in Southbridge and Sturbridge?
Paper. Textile,
right? And so if you want to ship textiles and stuff, you got to put them in boxes, right? And of course, everyone heated their homes with wood back then and so forth. So this is all grown up with trees again now, of course. So here's the brick mill. This is to the new mill pond. This is the new mill in 1880. I mean, these are pretty amazing buildings, as long ago as this is. But this was a major profit-making industry here. The new pond mill discharged into the river that next filled Dresser Manufacturing Dam Number 2, which fed the Central Mills Canal. The site of Dresser Dam Number 1, I actually found myself, having asked a manager in a factory less than 200 yards away if he knew where this was, and he had lived in town all his life, and he didn't know. So I think this was blown out in 1876, but haven't found the evidence for it. This is the Quinebaug River at the left, Central Mills Canal at the right, which I believe was destroyed during the March flood in 36. This is the American Optical Mechanic Street facility. This was the site of the Colombian cotton textile mill, which was one of the first. And that's downstream of the Central Mill Canal tailwater, which is where the very, very first dam privilege was developed in the early 1700s. So here's the AO, the canal is in the foreground. In 36, Ames Worsted bought the brick mill. The new mill was sold to Russell Harrington Cutlery, which had their original factory destroyed on Katy Brook, which is, its source was in Charlton. And that facility was destroyed in the March 36 flood. So based on 1920 records, Ames Worsted controlled nearly 3.5 billion gallons of lake and reservoir storage above the site of the U.S. Geological Survey stream gauge at Westville. So analysis of the historic stream gauge records show that August Q50, this is the median day flow, was 33 million gallons a day, which is the amount of water assumed to flow through the Ames system on a typical August day. So what we're going to do is we're going to generate daily stream flow data for the location using some stuff that I do. And I'm going to pass those flows through a single 3.4 billion gallon reservoir at the present site of the Westville stream gauge. And I'm actually going to compare my operation of this reservoir with the historic records, and we'll see what comes up. So the sole operating rule of this reservoir is to release 33 million gallons as often as needed for the mill, because we want to keep all three shifts working, right? So we don't want to release too much, but we want to make sure that we release enough to keep everything going and making money for the fat pads alone. So I'm going to split the stream flow into two data sets, from 1940 to 62, and then from 62 to 1990, when, thanks to the Massachusetts miracle budget, this gauge disappeared. So the mill operates from October 1st, 1940 to September 30th, 1955. I'm going to destroy the reservoir on October 1st. The mill owners sell out. All active reservoir management and daily water uses cease. So unregulated flow conditions in the Quinebaug persist from October 1st, 55 through September 30th, 1990, which was the last day of the USGS records for this site. And I'm going to compare these two sets, both pre and post 62, and model results. So here we go. So here's for the month of August. The white bars are USGS. The black bars are QPBQ simulation. I was actually asked under oath in court, why don't you call it the Fennessey transform, the judge asked. And I said, because it's easier to spell. So here we have the average daily flow for August, pre and post. So the pre period, I missed by quite a bit, and mostly that's because of the amazing amount of water that happens on that one day. So everyone talks about, you know, extreme observations. Sounds technical, but, you know, when you were a kid in the playground with a seesaw, what happens when the overweight kid sits on the seesaw? Well, the balance sort of goes to heck, all right? Well, the same thing happens with statistics. So the median day flows during both periods is absolutely dead on. And Q90 is a low statistic, so 90% of the days, the flows are higher than this much, and 10% they're lower. So also a very good match. The dashed line here, well, this is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service so-called minimum of 0.5 CFS per square mile. Well, we can't maintain it, remember, because half the time the flows are less. The only way we could maintain it is how?
Double it.
Build a big reservoir. Okay, anybody have kids here? Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably a few of you do. Do you give your kid an allowance? So there's a couple of things you can tell the kid. Here's X amount of dollars for the week. And you can blow it all on Friday night and have a good time. Or spend a little bit each day and have fun all week. Okay? The same thing happens with the reservoir, because believe it or not, the equations for a reservoir are the same as they are for your checking account. Okay? The balance depends on the deposits and the withdrawals. Okay. So unfortunately, the people who have this idea about sustaining the minimum, well, they want to party every night of the week like it's Saturday night. It can't happen. Sorry. So month of September, same deal. The statistics are actually a better match here. So I suggest let's accept conclusion four. Based on the historic evidence and mathematical evidence, the Quinebaug River was actually highly regulated before the hurricanes of 55 in August. And then since then, following the destruction of the textile industry, the sale of the actively regulated lakes, ponds, and reservoirs to American Optical to the surrounding towns, the river flows have reverted to a more natural, unregulated condition. So here's the Upper Fiskdale Dam. This is west of Sturbridge. And this is the remains of the Fiskdale Dam today. So all those blocks that you see in the river, those are actually massive granite stones from the dam. All this stuff was beautiful hand-laid stuff. And the dam itself was about 16 or 18 feet high. This is Big Pond Dam, 1920. Here it is today. I got out there in the wintertime. Hamilton Reservoir, this is in Holland, Mass. This is a lovely town. This reservoir was rebuilt as was the gatehouse and the dam. Lots of homes around the lake today, very, very pretty. This is Dresser Dam number one in the Canal Headworks in Southbridge. This is the one I think that was destroyed in 1876. This is the canal today. So I actually had to carefully choose my days to get these photographs so that the snow was gone, but the leaves hadn't popped out on the trees so that we could actually see what was in there. This is Walker Pond in Sturbridge. You actually drive over Walker Pond as you go on the Mass Pike. So the entrance ramp from Sturbridge onto the Mass Pike just crosses over this this culvert here just before you merge. The Walker Pond is to the north side, and this is where the wealthy textile owners spent their summers from both Sturbridge and Southbridge, was living on the shores of Walker Pond. Central Mills and the so-called Cowtail Pond in Sturbridge. So this is the site today, and also the site of the very first mill that was constructed in the Quinebaug back in 1732 and destroyed, I believe, in 1936. So the fisheries person was really excited about all these rocks and so forth in the river until I told them, well, they're actually remains of the old dam. There's nothing natural about them. So, Quinebaug River study conclusions. Quinebaug River is pleasantly flowing closer to a natural flow regime than it did before August 55. There is insufficient water storage available in East Brimfield Reservoir to augment flows to achieve the continuous target in-stream flow levels in Connecticut, as the activists, US EPA, and US Fish and Wildlife Service wanted. There is sufficient storage available to achieve target in-stream flow levels in Connecticut using what I call the pulse release strategy. So if you can't continuously release this much water, let's release it now and again and basically hit it on occasion. And this was inspired by a major release in the Colorado River, which basically flooded terracing there that hadn't been flooded since before the dam was constructed. A tremendous evolution of the ecology just from that single flood. And I said, hey, let's do it here. So, do this wonderful study, publish a nice fat report, and what do you think the comments were about it by U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Mass Division of Fish and Game, Connecticut DEP, Connecticut Fish and Game? What do you think their comments were?
You're wrong.
They refused to comment. No review comments. Absolutely astonishing. So this study, which was totally, you know, unexpected, completely turned the study upside down and literally changed water policy here in the Northeast United States. All because something felt a little wrong. It felt a little wrong. And now you understand how that can happen. And for a water resources engineer like me, that's the reason I get up in the morning, because this is really fun. So, Liz asked me to talk about data. I get stream gauge data from the U.S. Geological Survey. I also now get what's called digital elevation model data. Literally what the GS did was scan the topographic maps that you saw earlier on in the figure, and every 3 meters estimate what that elevation is. And now I can create a triangular network of elevations, which now I can use as a computer to analyze watershed topography. A lot easier than literally filling this room full of topographic maps trying to delineate the edge of the bathtub of a large watershed, which is exactly what we have to do here. We use daily precipitation, daily air temperature, and believe it or not, daily snowfall in the QPPQ transform. This comes from the National Weather Service, which is part of NOAA. We can get high quality information from the first order weather observatories, which are located at the metropolitan airports, for the summary of the day, volunteer network. We're here in Massachusetts, we've got something like 200 volunteer weather observers. In fact, two in Pelham, I don't know who they are. U.S. Department of Agriculture, they provided us with geographic information systems, soils data layers. It's important to know something about the soils, not just for engineering, as Chris alluded to, but the hydrologic properties, when rain falls on this stuff, how much soaks in and how much runs off. We need to know that. And we also need to know something about what covers that soil. So if we pave it all over, what does the rain do? It all runs off. Bad news. We want that stuff to soak into the ground. So that comes from Mass Geographic Information Service and Connecticut Geographical Information Service, because the watershed is in both Connecticut and Massachusetts. So she also asked about journals that publish stuff like this. So the American Water Resources Association. This isn't technically a great journal, but what it does is it reaches a wide audience. So policymakers, technical people, social science people, hydrologists, water resources source, political source, so a very, very wide audience. And the Journal of Water Resources Planning and Management, this is one of the journals published by the American Society of Civil Engineering. And that's that.